Good morning. Welcome here this morning to a celebration of life. It's a celebration of a life well lived. It is a difficult day, has been difficult the last couple of days and weeks, but God is here with us. God has been with us throughout this entire ordeal. God has walked with us through this valley. His promise this day is that he would continue to walk with us through this valley, that he would be our shield, he would be our shelter, he would be our hope, he would be our source of encouragement. So we gather this day in that certain assurance of the hope of Almighty God, to comfort, to celebrate, to honor life of Jerry Wayne. But just bow your heads and close your eyes with you as we begin with the word. Father of Heaven, thank you for this, your day. Thank you for your grace and mercy. Thank you for your love, your watch care, and your protection over us. Thank you, God, for all the things that you have done up until this point, how you have brought us to this place, and how you have walked with us through this valley. I thank you, oh God, for the Booth family. I thank you for family and friends gathering in to share and to celebrate in that which was the passing of too short of a life. We don't have all the answers. We don't even have all the questions. But God, this day we declare our faith, our trust, our reliance upon you. We look to you, we lean on you, and we ask, oh God, that you would be with us in the midst of this service, from the very beginning to the very end, and everything in between, oh God, that you would wrap your arms of healing, help, and love around us, that you would be that good shepherd that would shield us and shelter us in the shadow of the Most High. Pray, God, that you wrap your arms of love and comfort around all that are gathered here today, especially the family. Pray that you would just help us as we honor the memory, we glorify your name, and as we celebrate the life of Jerry. In the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, that we pray and ask all these things. Christ, all of God's people said,
amen.
We'll take a hymn there in front of you, some songs, some favorite hymns of Jerry and the family. We will share it again. Valley on is going to come to me that says we work too hard.
Hymn, Just a Closer Walk with Me, 67, three verses.
Jesus, keep me from all wrong. Walk with me. Jesus is my plea. Daily walking constantly, let it be to you, Lord, let it be. If I think of life is old, time for me will be no more. Guide me gently safe to shore, to the deep shore, to rest your just a close to walk with me. That in Jesus is my plea. Daily walking posture to me. Let it be to you, Lord. Let it be.
Good morning, everyone. It's good to have you here celebrating this time together in remembrance of Jerry. I want to read the obituary for you. Jerry Duane Booth was born January 26, 1960, to Johnny Truman and Rojane Booth in Roswell, New Mexico. Jerry was a driver for Renzen Burger in Temple, and he was most of his amazing massage therapy skills. And he enjoyed spending time with family and friends. He is survived by his parents, Truman and Rojane Booth, and two sons, Garrett Edward Booth of Colleen, and Grayson Roddy Booth of Temple. One daughter, Crystalline, Jeanette Cook of Temple. One brother, Johnny D. Booth of Little Elm. And one grandson, whom he loved very dearly. Any memorials that you would like to leave, families requested, would be made to the Nazarene Ministry. It was a privilege to get to know Jerry, and we had a lot of good visits together. He was especially a good cook, and we always enjoyed his cooking for the church with early morning breakfast and some meals and so forth. Jerry was a real inspiration to us, and we just loved and appreciated him dearly. It's not easy for us when we lose somebody out of a timely set, and it just doesn't seem to fit into the pattern of life. But Jerry lived well, and I know that the Lord was close to him and his companion, and that's what's most important for us, that we serve the Lord and follow him, so that when our time comes, we'll be ready. Thank you.
The Old Rugged Cross, number 233. Verses 1, 3, and 7. On the far away, stood an old rugged cross, the ever-living hopes of redemption.
might have been. May the good Lord bless and keep you till we meet again.
May you walk the sunlight shining
and the bluebird in every tree.
May there be a silver lining
back of every cloud you see. Fill your dreams with sweet tomorrows. Never mind what might have been. May the good Lord bless and keep you till we meet again. May the good Lord bless and keep you till we meet, till we meet again. My way growing clear, precious Lord, linger near. When my life is almost gone, hear my cry, hear my call. Hold my hand, lest I fall. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me on. Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I'm weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me. When my work is all done and my race here is run, let me see by the light thou hast shown that fair city so bright where the lamp is the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I'm weak, I'm worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home.
You know, I realize this is a celebration. It's like not a number. Star move. Don't look that. I'm trying to work on my film. He is in a better place. He looked on him. He loved Jesus. He always has. He was ready to go. He thought himself was going to go. He wasn't very healthy. And he was always ready to believe it. He was always making sure that I knew what he wanted. just took him away that we didn't have to see him, but see him the way he would want us to see him. And I do thank you for that. Thank you to remember like this. Anything we could do. I'll tell a dozen stories about him. He was a jokester. A lot of people really probably know that and have experienced that firsthand. There was a time, it was a different church. It's kind of similar, like, because I was in the secretary's office up here. And he found this. You know, it's coming. He found this horny toad. A lot of people just never seen it in their life, no clue what it is. And so he gets with the secretary there, and he kind of gets her going and just starts her conversation. He has a kind of hit, like, you know, on his lap or something. And he used it several times and a lot of different breaks he did. He would start the conversation about knowing that it would go towards demons eventually. And so he went towards demons. And so she had to go something in the other room for a second, and he got that thing out, put it on her desk, face where she was, and things didn't have been made better, and said, you stayed exactly there, waited for her to come back. And she comes back, sits back down, his neck to work, and didn't even notice for a second, and all of a sudden, she sees it, and she just freaks. Everything goes crazy. One time, he's in so, anyway, we get some laughter for you, all. Another time, Zach's expense, he had some fun with him. Zach was being so nice to him, helped him put in his overhead, over the range hood, and his thing in his kitchen, and he's doing the wires for him, and Zach was being very cautious that he should, making sure that he turned off all the electricity and everything to it, and so Dad waited until he was up in it, working on the wires. He got this guy right here. And scared the bejesus out of him. One overreacting. He did jump real good. And we're never gonna let Zach live that one down. I don't know if I'm gonna steal anybody else's stories. We talked about the demons, I'll bring up another game. He was a youth pastor in New Mexico, I believe it was, right? And he went to the Bonita park there at the Nazarene campsite in New Mexico. He was actually just trying to work on rebuilding after the fire. But the teens would always try to get him. He had this motion detector by his tents to make sure that nobody could prank him. And so it would go off, and it was awesome. So he made sure that he couldn't get beat up. But because they kept trying, he decided they won't have to. And so he goes over, they're in their tents, they gather around the flashlight, he didn't actually steer it, but they start talking about angels. And so he waited, and sure enough, they start talking, they're getting quiet, for my time. And so he He waited until 1 month, and I realized quiet moment that he was real intense. And one of the team, one of the team boys, back through the tent wall.
Oh.
The tent was destroyed. All of them were out in moments, and the tent was destroyed. And that's my dad. He really enjoyed life. And he kind of, I got a lot of that from him. A lot of people have also figured out that I like to meet some people and have fun too. And I think that's more of a better quality to cover. So.
I will say that I did bring visual effects. Chris and Paul last night asked about business, or someone would. To be perfectly honest, they didn't want to. So I heard later, I thought about it, and I thought, well, you know what, I'll put my notes on the old iPhone. So I'm going to read some of this. I'm not going to be firsthand because I want to talk about jobs. You know what? It's been a while. So this is closer to current times. It's funny because you'll have to see if you recognize any of this. Some of it, I decided to start with the fact that he loves animals and frogs. He had several dogs, cats, ferrets during his life. For instance, when we go to Houston, see our grandparents, when we were children, there were little square places that were missing in the brickwork in front of the grandparents' house. And he was always there prodding out frogs, trying to catch a frog. And so if he wasn't in the house, we knew that he was probably in the front yard chasing reptiles. He also enjoyed puzzles. He enjoyed games of challenge. He always had a chess board around real close. He had a terrific memory. He could remember every event in our childhood, good or bad, mostly the things I did to him, though. He never saw the same one. One event I couldn't deny was the scar on his hand. And anybody close to him knows the story. So I might as well confess. One time when we were very young, my mother walked away from her ironing board, and I asked him, "Would you like your hand ironed?" "Is it my fault that he put his hand up there?" See if this sounds familiar. He got a strong sense of humor, enjoyed a good laugh. Good thing, huh? For many years, he and I teamed up to terrorize friends of our parents. We had these air bazookas. I don't know if you saw these, those of you who've been around a while, but we used to have air bazookas where we had to pump them up to get air pressure. And the parents would have friends come over, and we would pump it up as far as we could, and we'd creep through the house. And dealing with the air blast as the bazooka go off. And so my parents went through a lot of friends. We also had a lot of adventures that other brothers did. For a while, we lived in Goose Bay, Labrador. This is in Canada. My dad was in the Air Force, so we lived on Goose Air Base. And we got to do things that people usually talk about walking around sometimes to school in the snow. The snow wasn't just snow, it with the help of drifts and snow plows, and sometimes just the weather could get as high as 10 feet or more. And so we got the chance and opportunity to do things in the snow that other people just dream about. There were times when we'd be pulled around on sleds by our parents in the car. We were always being chased by our Dobson at the time. Built snow forts, we could dig in the snow to find the top of street signs. That's how deep the snow was. Our family went to church in a local community. It was off the Air Force Base, so the Newfoundlanders were a little wary of the ugly Americans sometimes, but we became part of their community. And every Sunday morning we went to church, every Sunday afternoon we go to Sunday school. Quite a commitment. And then in the middle of the week, Jerry and I would go to a youth meeting where it's kind of a Boy Scout type thing where we wore uniforms, we learned scripture, and we learned to sing Old Canada together. Jerry was a good brother, and he's a strong Christian, he's a devoted father, and he's very proud.
You made it.
I'm a little bit too tired to remember this. Garrett stole, a couple of those stories. But Dad was a prankster. He really, really was. And one story I remember him as being especially proud of, it was to that poor secretary, the same one with the horny toad. I don't know how long she lasted at that particular church, but I can't imagine it's as long as other. But one time he found a baby rattlesnake that had just died, and so he curled it into the little position, and he put it right next to an outlet. And then he went and he asked the secretary to go plug something in, and that secretary just about died.
Yeah,
he got the pastor after that. It was a change. Yeah, it was an ongoing thing. He got more than one people with that one. But another story, I'm glad that the Robertsons came. We had a lot of afterglows when the teens came over to our house or somebody else's house. But after church, and this particular time, it was at our house, and we had a 4.5 foot long rat snake. And Kai is very scared of snakes. And anyways, while everyone was playing with the snake in my room, Kai was on the other side of the house. Until he got a little curious, and he came up and he was just barely on the edge of the door and watching that snake intently from a distance. My dad came up on all fours, snuck up behind him, and pinched his ankle, and Kai jumped. I've never seen anybody jump that high or scream that loud. I wasn't there with Zach. Anyways, there's tons of pranks and jokes, it's a way of, I can't give justice to the rat snake story. If Bubba wants to come up and tell, or Garrett wants to tell it.
Go ahead.
That was just hilarious how he, we actually got the red snake. If you want, I can. Anyways, okay. Garrett was at camp. Children's camp, teen camp, something like that. And they were having a water fight, and it was counselors against campers. Well, anyways, then the campers are going, snake, snake, snake. And, you know, Dad being, you know, he's wary of pranks because he's walked away. And so he's thinking that if the campers are trying to lure him into a trap. So, but, you know, being a camp counselor, you know, he has to check it out. So he went around, and sure enough, there was a snake. And Bubba was there as well. And forgive me if I get this wrong, but one of them picked up the end of the snake. The tail.
No, I picked it up, and I was scared of it. So it started crawling up my arm, so I turned around and went like this, and Jerry was standing behind me, and I hit him by the side of the head with the snake.
So if you guys didn't hear that, Bubba managed to pick up the end, the tail of the snake, okay, before he even knew what type of snake this was. And of course, the snake came crawling back up. And so Bubba flung it so as to straighten it out. Well, that my dad was standing right there. And so then they're doing this little dance. So, you know, it's the snake dance. Anyways, we found out it wasn't poisonous. And we ended up taking it in the pillowcase. People in the band didn't know, and they had it just in a with a pillow, and Dad's holding the pillow, and none of the other counselors know. Garrett knows, and so Garrett keeps going, Dad, can we have a pillow? Dad, can we have a pillow? And Dad's like, no, you can't have a pillow. So everybody, you know, in the band's going, why can't the kid have a pillow? You know, and then once we got back to the parking lot, then they found out, oh, there was a snake here. It was all lady counselors in that band, so. They knew that if they found out about the snake, it would be on the side of the road. So. But yeah, that's where you got the snake. Anyways, on a different note, this is my dad's photo album from his parents, and I have to admit, I didn't even see this until yesterday. And it was out there, and I'll probably put it back out there for you guys to look at in the next couple minutes. But it's got pictures of him from birth through hospital. She saved everything. And there's two things I wanted to point out. This first page, it's in little kid handwriting, so he couldn't have been very old, but it says, hi, my name is Jerry. My best friend's name is Jesus. And the reason he's my best friend is because he died for me. I can't see him, but I can talk to him and feel him. I'm going to meet him person someday. And I know that's true. And he's also a poet, and also in the front there's a bunch of his poems. And he's titled this one, The Very Pretty Star. It says, I saw a star. It was a very pretty star. As I watched the star, it twinkled at me, this very pretty star. I wished upon this star. And as I wished upon it, this very pretty star, I watched it change form. It changed into a man in a robe of white, encircled by hundreds of angels. It came closer and closer until I could hear a trumpet. I soon felt myself rising along with my others, many others, to meet this very pretty star. Yes, my wish had come true. Yeah. I know he's in heaven, and he's in a better place. And I don't know, I don't know if we ever prank you, it's out of love.
We all got it.
Dear Jerry, you are the love of my life. I will miss you more than words can say. You have been a bright line in my life for the past year and a half now. When I first met you, you healed me in so many ways. When I was at my lowest point, you have given me that sense of purpose and also having something to look forward to. Your beautiful blue eyes have been like calm waters to me. I will cherish the beads that you made with your own hands and to proudly wear the necklaces I made out of them. Before your death, I let it be known how much I loved you and you for me. I will miss talking to you on the phone every day, being the stable force that guided me. As a special man that loves all his family as much as you have, you are in a glorious place now. No more suffering, no more illness, only peace with God and his person. Jerry, I will love you forever and miss you with all my heart.
What a friend we have in Jesus. 625. All of you. What we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs for them. Oh, Lord, we'll lift you heavenly. Everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forget.
friend. What a friend we have in Jesus. Would encourage you to, as I know you have been, but over the next few days and weeks and months, to come continue to lift up this family in prayer, because this is what they need, that solace, that encouragement. These memories that they have shared are precious memories. Some of them are great things, some of them stories maybe you've never heard before. And I'm sure, no doubt, each and every one of you have some stories that you might share. I want to encourage you over the next days and weeks and even months to come, as something comes to mind, a memory of something that happened, a memory of Jerry, a time spent with him, something that might just cheer the family up. Would you just take a moment as those memories come to you? Not necessarily here today. We'll need to bombard them here today with all those things. But as those memories come up over the next days and weeks and months to come, would you pick up the phone? Would you just call Garrett or Crystal or Grayson and let them know what memories that might be in? Or would you just write out a little note? Share that little story. That note of encouragement that might support them and help them. Visited with the family there yesterday, just a little bit in preparation for the funerals today. And we talked a little bit about the service and the details of putting this service together. And Garrett made mention of something that I thought was very interesting, something that maybe I didn't personally know, just being a relatively new pastor here at Temple First Nazarene. Is that Jerry was very into prophecy. As a matter of fact, as I often like to do, I like to go through their Bible, and I have Jerry's Bible here in front of me, one of his Bibles. And I found that in the fly leaf, a little leaflet on a prophecy conference that he had gone to recently, and talks about the signs of the coming of the end of the age. And how we know these things, and prophecy in the news, and how we can be prepared for those things. My mind turned to a prophetic word of Jesus. It's really probably could be classified and called a prophecy of hope, if I were to give it a label. And as I flip to John chapter 14, very familiar passage of scripture, I noticed that Jerry had it highlighted in his Bible as well. It's something that he took hold of, something that he took to heart and recognized and realized that this prophetic word of Jesus, as Jesus foretold of things to come, as he talked about the future and how things would happen, as he began to prepare those disciples for the imminent days ahead that they would face, he shared these words with them. Red letter words, a red letter edition of the Bible, signifying the very words of Jesus Christ himself. And if I could, I would share these very words of Jesus with you, family, friends, this day. A prophetic word of hope from Jesus himself. John chapter 14, beginning at verse 1, Jesus preparing the disciples for the days ahead. And Jesus preparing you and I, even, for the days ahead, said these words, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you." Jesus said, "I am going to prepare a place for you. And if I go and I prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself. That where I am, you may be also. Where I go, you know. And the way, you know." Thomas speaks up. Thomas says, "Lord, we do not know where you're going, so how can we know the way?" And Jesus utters those most famous and precious of words in John chapter 14, verse 6. Again, Jerry has this highlighted. Jesus says, "I am. I am the truth. I am the light. No one comes to the Father except through. Just quickly this morning, as we wind down this service, this celebration of life, if there was just a few things, a handful of things that I know without a doubt from the conversations, the times that I've had with Jerry in the last few short months, from the testimonies that you have heard from his own family in this very celebration service. There's some things that God's word is clear that Jerry knew and Jerry believed, and that he would want to have passed on and did pass on to his children. And we want you to know as well. According to this prophetic word of Jesus, heaven is real. If you believe that, say amen.
Amen.
That's the good news this morning. And though this world is full of strife and full of problems and full of difficulties and full of heartache and full of pain, heaven is a real place. God has prepared it. Lots of people talk about an idea or a concept of heaven. And sometimes it's a made-up imaginary idea. It's a made-up concept. But I want you to know and understand, according to the very words of Jesus Christ, the very words of God himself, heaven is a real place. Jesus says in John chapter 14, verse 2, he said, in my Father's house, there are many, many mansions. If it were not so, he said, I would have let you in on it. I would have told you. But it is real. It is a very real place. And guess what? Second thing that God would want you to know, that he desires for all of us to end up there one day. Amen? He desires that all of us would enter there. He said, if I go, I am going to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. Heaven is a real place. God has created it. He has designed it for each and every one of us. And his desire is that we would go there with him. And we rejoice this day, because that which Jerry has believed, that's what Jerry has believed, this day he has received. Amen? All the times that he has discussed and talked about the coming of the Lord and the return of the Lord, the coming of the end of the age, the reality of heaven, the reality of angels and demons, we've heard talk about this day. That which he has believed, today he has received. I think he would want you to know that heaven's a real place. It's better than he could have ever imagined. It's better than we could ever have dreamed. It's more magnificent than anything that would be described over the book of Revelation, though it tries its very best to try and describe that beautiful place. It is a place that God has created for us, and most importantly, it is a place that God wants to carry us to himself. But I think God's word would want us to know that just believing in God is not enough. Jesus says here in John chapter 14, he says, you believe in God? So that's good. Believe also in me. In John chapter 14, verse 6, Thomas is trying to figure out where Jesus is going and how they're going to get there. And he's thinking about it in the physical realm, and Jesus is speaking of the spiritual realm. And Jesus finally tells him, he says, I am the way, the truth, the life. No one comes to the Father except through Jesus Christ. you know, we come to this point, this time, and these services, and I, of course, as a pastor for a number of years, been a part of a lot of funeral services, and we all want to talk about heaven, and everybody wants to go there. Amen? I haven't met anybody that seriously does not want to go to heaven. But the reality is that just believing in God is not enough. Jerry knew that. Just being a good person has never been enough. You and I could never earn our way into heaven. We could never earn our salvation. It comes through faith in Jesus Christ alone. Have our sins forgiven by the shed blood of Jesus Christ. I have no doubt that Jerry would want me to tell you exactly what Jesus says. That just believing in God, in the existence of a God, or some God, has never been enough. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through a right relationship with His Son, Jesus Christ. We must repent of our sins. We must have our sins forgiven. Oh, if we want to see God, if we want to see His heaven, if we want to spend an eternity with Jerry, we need to get sure, be sure that our lives are right at the moment. I'm reminded of a story of a Christian missionary speaking with a Muslim and a Buddhist. They were talking about religion, they were talking about God, they were talking about faith, they were talking about all these things. And finally the conversation came to the place in which the Muslim and the Buddhist, they were trying to explain and trying to comprehend what this Christian missionary was talking about. And finally the Christian missionary said, let me just see if I can sum this up. He said, you believe that God is like a being on top of the mountain. And there are various ways to get to the top of that mountain. Some of you might climb from this side, and some of you might climb from this side. But all roads lead to God. Is that what you believe? And they said, yeah, exactly. You finally got it. Christian missionary said, but what if the real understanding is that God on top of the mountain stepped down out of heaven, made His way down into the valley to show us the way. He said, let me tell you about Jesus, the way, the truth, the life. You see, it's not about us finding God. It's that God found us. It's that God found Jerry. I'm amazed at the testimony that Jerry's father was sharing. I've heard it from Jerry before about how at a young age he was not expected to live. Out of fact, doctors, hospital, all but given up. Family went to pray. Family went to believe him, trust him. God mightily and miraculously worked a miracle in his life and gave him a lived long life, far beyond what anybody would have ever used. Was it cut short? Absolutely. Should it have been longer? We sure would have hoped so. Thank God for what He has done. We rejoice in how God continues to work, and how God stepped out of heaven and made a difference in Jerry's life and wants to make a difference in your life and mine. The good news is this day, it's from that first verse that Jesus said. He says, let not your heart be troubled. You know what? This life is full of difficulties, it's full of problems, it's full of troubles. But thanks be to God, we can have the trust and a faith and assurance. We don't have to have our hearts troubled. We can believe in God. We can put our hope and faith in Him and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ as Jerry did. And we can receive one day what we believe. Does that mean all of life's pain and problems disappear? Absolutely not. Does that mean that these types of things don't hurt? Does that mean that all the questions disappear? Absolutely not. There's a whole lot of questions that we don't understand. Hope is result of God's amazing grace. We can have a peace that passes all understanding. Peace that I'm confident that Jerry had right up to the very end. You see, you can go to the grave of Muhammad, Buddha. You can go to the graves of all these so-called religious leaders. And their grave is full. You can find an old cutaway tomb out of a cave on the side of a hill, garden. You'll find that Jesus is not there. He's alive. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know Jesus is. May we rejoice. May we hold on to that hope that God has given us. God, share it. Jerry's life, we want you to share. I encourage you to seek God as Jerry sought God. The promise of God's word is that if you seek him, he will be found by you. Close with a word of prayer, after which there will be a song, one of Jerry's favorite songs. After we pray, we should just listen. Let's share this final closing song. Father in heaven, thank you for this day. Thank you for your grace and mercy. Thank you for your grace that has seen us through a very difficult day, a very difficult time. The struggles of this past week and a half that have been very difficult. But in the midst of all of this, O God, we have seen and felt and known your hand. You have been there with us. You have guided us and directed us. You have led us. You have upheld us. You have comforted us and you have strengthened us. We thank you, O God, for the life of Terry New England. Thank you for the memories that have been shared, the laughter that has been enjoyed. And I pray, God in heaven, that you would pour out your blessings upon this man, upon his mother and father, his brother, upon his children, Crystal and Garrett, Grayson, and all the family that is gathered here and friends that are gathered here today. I pray, God, for your hand of comfort, shelter, shadow of the Most High, Jesus, precious and holy.
My latest son is seeking my grace. It's nearly gone. My strongest trials now or past, and my triumph is begun. Oh, come. Oh, bear me away from your snow.
almost gave my head my spirit loudly said, the only ones be told they come, I hear the noise of rain, to order my heart to help who lived and died for me, whose blood now cleanses from all sin and gives me victory. All come, angel band, come and around me stand.
Thank you. Thank you.